Hello, my name is Anthony Seha from the San Diego County Office of Education, this System of Supports Department, and this video will focus on the importance and the benefit of mindfulness in connection with restorative practices. So I am going to share some of my slides with you, just a few. And so you have my email there, and you can reach me via email if you have any questions or comments or anything. And at the end, you'll have an opportunity to maybe engage in a short evaluation. So when we talk about the importance of mindfulness, I'm going to kind of do this and just like, what is the connection between mindfulness and restorative practices? And the reality is if you understand the larger definition of restorative practices, meaning this, that every interaction, every human interaction that we have is an opportunity to help to restore people in their sense of value and worth, their sense of connection to the community. So now, in order for me to be kind of an instrument of helping to restore people, or I guess you could even use the word to heal some of the harm that's been done to many of our students and just staff, colleagues, parents, that is hard work. That means I must be ready to teach through every interaction. So it goes so far beyond just teaching curriculum. It's teaching that we care about the people who are in our sphere of influence, right? So we need to be mindful to do that, because life is very busy and there's a lot of emotions and things going on, and we can easily get off track, which I do many times. But I do try to practice this, and this photo is not, it's not like I'm going into deep meditation or anything like that. But what I've recognized is that if I'm going to be an effective restorative practitioner, that I need to be well. I need to be clear in my thinking. I need to be aligned with who I am as an educator and what is it that I want to teach, right? So that I know, if I know clearly what I want to teach, I'm going to be able to achieve that goal. If I get off track and I allow everything to start reacting to things, I can easily become a part of the problem, which many, many of our students have experienced, feeling maybe pushed out of the class or pushed out of the school, or a feeling of being demeaned or devalued. And some of them have even experienced that at home. So it becomes really traumatizing for many people. What we're saying is, as educators dedicated to doing this work, we are going to work to restore these students and even the adults back to a good, positive, healing relationship in our school community, in that safe environment that we are going to intentionally and strategically create. And so when we think of mindfulness, I'm gonna kind of show you something that we tend to use just as a very pleasant something to look at. What we, what we do is we focus on our breathing. And we actually ask students to do this with us. Our breathing and breathing with students actually is one simple way of us connecting in our humanity, because at the kind of foundation of our humanity or of our human being, we need breath. Breath is the sign of life for us. So we actually breathe with the young people, and we'll have a plug and play video that will kind of, you, if you're uncomfortable doing any of this, leading any of this, you could just basically play it and it'll kind of do it for you. But I think it's important that as educators, that we help young people to also become mindful and understand that they have power in themselves to focus themselves, to calm themselves down, to, you know, connect with themselves, even, you know, become more self-aware. We know that that's a social, emotional, learning, important characteristic, right? To be self-aware, to be aware of your feelings, what's going on in you. So what we typically do is we say like maybe 60 to 90 seconds of just a kind of a breathing activity where people can breathe deeply together. And we even ask people to use their imagination and kind of breathe in something positive for themselves, and then breathe out anything that's weighing them down, you know, kind of like a way to kind of release through your breath some of that heaviness that many of our kids, many adults are carrying. And we breathe in the positive and we breathe out the negative, and we just kind of guide people to do that. And basically what it's doing is it's helping them recognize that they're powerful human beings, that they have a power to begin to be well. I know that these are strange maybe concepts for some people listening, but it's important that young people discover themselves as powerful human beings. And breathing is the very beginning of it. And their minds, the power of their minds. And so we also kind of ask them to set an intention. As they're breathing, we choose like our own intention. We know that kids make choices all day long to pay attention, not pay attention, to show up, not show up, or misbehave or behave. We're saying you have the power to choose, because the reality is they do have the power to choose. We're just reminding them of that, helping them become conscious, because oftentimes the choices are being made unconsciously, subconsciously. And so we're saying, let's start to make mindful choices, right? Choices that are healthy for us and good for us and empowering to us. And so it's important, I believe, that as educators that we model, right, this mindfulness and a mindful behavior. Because as the young people see us, they begin to go, wow, you know, there's a peace about them. There's a wellness about them. And I want to be around them. I want to learn from them. So we need to model that. So we'll have a plug and play that will just kind of be a quick sort of, again, 2-minute sort of thing that you can use if you think that's useful to you. And down below, if you scroll down, you'll see the link for the evaluation. We appreciate any kind of feedback that we get. It really does help us to learn and find out if this was helpful to you. Thank you.